beginning and the end. I made you a promise I would be your.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our Wednesday night Bible study. And I'd just like to take the time to say welcome to each and every one of you who've taken the time to join with us tonight. I'm also glad that there are people not only in this country, but outside of this country, overseas, that have joined in. And you've taken your time to be here each week with us. And we just want to say a very special thank you to you as well. We are grateful for God's guidance, for His help, for His strength, His keeping power, because sometimes when you consider everything that happens in our lives, not just the pandemic, but other things, and how God has kept us, especially when we put all our trust in Him, and then He came through for us, and one would say, just in the nick of time, and we're grateful for that. And so tonight we want to give our God all the praise and all the glory. We also want to remind each and every one of you to continue to pray. I know several weeks ago I asked everyone to try to find at least an hour a day, and some of you might be struggling. Don't beat yourself up, but just pray. Call on the Lord and find that special time when you go before Him to pray each and every day. And you'd be surprised that as you begin to pray and you're partnering with the Lord in touching lives all around you. Sometimes we may not even know the people we're praying for, but because you're praying, you're touching a life. And I would like you to know that God sees that and He honors that. And as you're praying for people, you'll see that your prayer time will actually increase. Don't try to make it increase. Go before the Lord and call on Him. Amen. I'm so grateful that you're joining us tonight. And tonight we have a special Bible study. I won't keep you long. But the Lord placed something on my heart, and I just want to talk to you from my heart. We're living in a time that is unprecedented, and it doesn't mean that God has any less power. In fact, He has no less power than He had before all the things that transpired in our world came to pass. But God is still God. He still sits on the throne. And tonight, we want to worship Him. How many of you want to give yourself to the Lord tonight? Amen. How many of you want to give yourself to Him? I know that every single person is putting their hand up tonight. Well, tonight we're going to be talking about just that. Amen. But before you can give yourself to the Lord, you've got to figure out who you are. I don't know about you, but I'm always looking for different ways that I can tune the world out, tune out what's happening all around me, and just think of the Lord. Think about what God wants out of my life and how I can impact the kingdom of God in a positive way, touching lives, and how much more can I touch lives than I am right now. It's always in my mind. And sometimes we can get so busy, even doing church work, and even pastors especially can get so busy trying to get from the next sermon to the next Bible study, dealing with the issues that pastors have to deal with sometimes. And some weeks are more crazy than others when people are going through trying times. And especially now during COVID, it's so much easier for people to talk to you on the phone. So that can increase and it can begin to take away the focus of what God wants for the kingdom. And while we have to do those things, we also have to keep in mind that God may have us on a mission, and if we're not paying attention, we'll miss that mission. That goes for every person. And so tonight, I want to talk to you a little bit about who you are. I'm considering some of the things that's happening in our world today. And yeah, every time you turn around, there's something new happening. All around our world, we find that we're seeing things that we've never seen before. In fact, many of you know that in Europe, in the UK, in China, India, and other parts of the world, that people are struggling with all these extreme weather situations that's occurred, that's caused massive floods everywhere, and just strange things are happening. Millions of people are homeless, and people are struggling. But as I said to the church on Sunday, while these things are happening, that we, the people of God, we know the end. We know what the Word of God says. And so we should not panic, fear, or doubt. What we should do, as the Lord said we should do, is look up, for our redemption draws nigh. But sometimes we are conflicted with that because we don't really know who we are. We're still struggling with the past, many of us, and we're still struggling with even issues going on in our lives right now. Struggling with so much that places doubts in our minds. But tonight, I want to talk a little bit about who you are. Because if we can determine who we are, I really believe that it will solidify our faith in Him, the one who came from heaven above to die for each and every one of us. And so tonight, I want us to go to the scriptures. Again, the title of tonight's Bible study or Bible lesson, my little talk, if you will, is who am I? Who am I? When we break that down, what does that really mean? In 1 Samuel chapter 16, beginning at verse 6, and we'll read verses 6 and 7. Here is Samuel. Let me just set this up. The Lord said, Samuel, I'm not pleased with the current king. Saul was anointed as king, but now he's not doing right. And he's certainly not doing what I want him to do. He's allowing idolatry to come in to Israel. He's not stomping it out. He's also allowing himself to be taken in by the ways of doing things like other nations, and he's not doing things according to how I want him to do it. And he's leading my people astray. He said, the Lord said, Samuel, I don't want him to be king anymore. So I want you to go to a man by the name of Jesse's house, and I want you to anoint his son king. The issue was Jesse had several sons. Samuel begins to go through them, and every time he sees one, he asks Jesse, bring the next one. The Lord would say, that's not the one. So Samuel said, do you have another son? Where is he? Well, you know, he's just a young one. He's out there tending sheep. And so Samuel said, go get him. And when David comes in, the Lord says, that's the one. And here is where we're going to pick it up. When they arrived, Samuel saw Eliab and thought, surely the Lord's anointed stands here before the Lord. But the Lord said to Samuel, do not consider his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him. The Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. When Samuel was sent to anoint this new king, he learned that God's measure of an individual was so different than his. And tonight, we want to look at who we are based on God's measurement of who we are, because sometimes we can judge ourselves so harshly, and rightly so, because I've often talked to you guys about holding ourselves responsible for who we are, what we do, and that hasn't changed. But it doesn't mean that now you beat up on yourself and you cause yourself to be in a place where you God can't reach you anymore because you are so fixated on your failures and your weaknesses, and you don't realize that you must stand in his hands. Let him hold you. So tonight, I want to go before the Lord in prayer. Pray for me that God will give me the words to speak to you. And we want to just approach the throne of grace with faith tonight, that when we leave this Bible study tonight, we'll walk away different than we came in to this Bible study. Let us pray. Mighty God, we come to you tonight. We are so grateful, God, for the word of God. Thank you for the truth that comes to us through the Holy Spirit. We're so grateful, God, that you have kept each and every one of us. Yes, we have lost some. And God, we've come through a harrowing year, a time when much fear and doubt and anxieties crushed most, Lord God, and even the strong felt conflicted and as though, Lord, they weren't going to make it. But Lord, here we are, and we are grateful for that. Thank you so much. And tonight, God, we want to give ourselves to you. But we want to give ourselves to you with knowledge of the word, knowledge of how you perceive us, and help us, dear God, to begin to put those things in place so that we can allow you to finally do the work of transformation in each and every one of us. And somebody said, in Jesus' name, amen, amen. And so we find here with the word of God, Samuel is now being addressed by the Lord. And the Lord says, don't consider his appearance. When Eliab came in, the Lord says, Samuel, that's not him. You're looking at his appearance, his height. But he says, I've rejected him. He's not the one, Samuel. The Lord doesn't look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. The same is so true today. God measures the individual, the person, much differently than we measure ourselves or we measure others. In this lesson, I want to review the measure often used by us, how we perceive people. We see certain things, especially coming from a church background, and we want to stop all of what we're doing and see how God measures and begin to do it God's way. Amen. And we'll find out how, by measuring things the way we measure things, how sometimes we can be so outside of the will of God, and how very often it'll limit growth. It'll limit our growth in him, and it will limit certainly others and the way they grow in their Christian walk with the Lord. Amen. So we often are find that we measure ourselves or Christians by their attendance at church. You know, if you show up at church every week, you're good to go. You're a strong Christian. You're a faithful Christian. And so, you know, we also say if you don't come to church a lot, that measures some issues that are going on, indicates some issues that are going on in the individual's life. And we may say that the weak people are the ones who don't attend church a lot, etc. And some of that might be true. Some of it may be because of circumstances in life, work and responsibilities and so on and so forth. And people beat themselves up because they can't get to church. And I'm one that believes that no matter what you do, you never give up trying to get yourself in that place in your life. Keep fighting for the ability to get into the house of God and to be in the presence of the Lord when worship is happening, because a lot of times healing and deliverances happen right there in the church service before a message is even preached. That's right. That's how God works many times. And when there is we talk about storms all over the world and extreme weather all over our world where people are being flooded out. Well, can I tell you, a lot of those extreme situations that occur will often occur in the presence of God when the people of God gather together and are all worshiping. Amen. And this deluge that just falls from heaven and just comes down, God can do so much before a song is sung and before a sermon is even preached. The word is important. I'm not taking away from the word, but I'm saying that when two or three are gathered together, the Lord says there's something mighty when we come together in a unified way that God begins to do something. So we ought to fight for that. But you cannot measure the growth of a Christian by how many times they attend church. So a lot of people attend church and they're not right with God. Oh, they're very faithful. And I'm glad that they're coming because hopefully something will help them in their lives. A word spoken. Something happens as God begins to move upon them, as worship happens in the church and the Spirit of God begins to move and something happens in their hearts and they are convicted. They run to that altar. They repent. I mean, God can do so much when they're in church. But then there are some that are so religious minded that the religion has them captivated into a lie that if I stay religious, I'm going to make it to heaven. And that's not true either. Because it doesn't matter what we think, it's what we do in our obedience to the Lord that matters. Remember, Jesus spoke to his disciples concerning the Pharisees. And these Pharisees were very dedicated. They went to the synagogue on a regular basis. They even made it clear that they fasted twice a week and they gave tithes of all they possessed. They were there, man. I mean, they knew the law in and out. They knew the word of God. But if you looked at their private lives, you would find out that as much as they were faithful to the church, they were not faithful in living righteous before God, even before the people. And so it's important for us to understand that the attendance going to church is not enough. Then, of course, sometimes we look at someone's leadership abilities in the church. You know, we're considered strong Christians if we lead prayer and if we are leading in singing and singing on the choir, if we're musicians, if we help with the Lord's Supper, if we teach classes, even if we're preaching. You know, the pastor asked me to preach if we're a part of the women's group, the men's group. You know, being busy does not dictate your growth, and it doesn't necessarily indicate that you're a strong child of God. Clean the church building, sweep the building, fix the outside and fix the roof. You're outside doing, trimming the trees, doing stuff. And even if you're visiting people and you're visiting the sick, you're leading in that area of your lives. And you know what the Bible says in the Word of God. And it's very clear how sometimes we forget what the Bible says. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, it says very clearly, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but have not charity, I am nothing. The Bible says, though I give my body to be burned, I am nothing. Though I give all I possess to feed the poor, to take care of the afflicted and the poor, if I don't have charity, I'm nothing. So, you know, it's not that we have leadership skills and abilities or we're even leading in doing religious things or even helping people. Amen. The tendency is to judge what we see. The tendency a lot of times is to judge the appearance. And because of some of these tendencies, the use of such measures is shaped with the potential of misjudging an individual and even misjudging our own walk with God. We'll even condemn one another based on what we see, what we perceive. And so we have to be very careful. And so when I began to think about this, I thought, we as the people of God need to know truly who we are. If we can get that understanding, a lot of this misunderstanding that we have with how we're perceiving things would mitigate those things a lot easier. We would navigate these pitfalls that Satan tries to bring our way so many times a lot easier. Amen. The measure of a strong Christian. I thought about this, and I've even taught on, how we perceive ourselves so many times in so many different ways. But as I began to think about this and who we really are and how should we perceive ourselves, I thought of Jesus. And I thought of a sermon that he preached in Matthew chapter 5. And it was so interesting what the Bible said. The Bible says that, and he went up into a mountain, and when he sat down, the King James Version says when he was set, that his disciples came unto him, the crowds and everyone that were there. And the Bible says he taught them, saying, he opened up his mouth and he begins to teach these people, his disciples, those that followed him daily, faithfully, and the people who, quite frankly, probably some of them never met him before, but they were all sitting there on the mountainside as Jesus sat down to teach. We often call that the Beatitudes, the Beatitudes. And he says in verse 3, blessed are the poor in spirit. Amen. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. And blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you when men or people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. The King James Version says, falsely persecute you, say all kinds of evil things against you falsely for his name's sake. And then it says here in verse 12, rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. They persecuted the prophets who were before you. Sometimes when we judge, when we do not understand who we are, we tend to want to, be spiritually solid in the way people perceive us by the things they perceive that we do. But we're poor inside. We're weak inside. We're struggling inside because we lean so much. We put so much effort and work on the outward appearance that the inside has been dying for a long time. There's been stunted growth in the inner person, the inner man, as the Bible calls that. The spiritual individual that resides deep within us, our souls are neglected. And so the soul isn't growing, but our outward appearance, oh, we've got that right. We've got that right. And folks can remain spiritually immature if this is the only measure that you've ever known. The only measure that you've ever known. But we find here, the Bible says that all these things that are happening in your life, as we read from verse 3 all the way through to verse 11, blessed and are the poor in spirit, and blessed are the meek, and blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Taken in verse 12 says, when all these things are happening in your life and you're blessed and people are reviling you, insulting you, and persecuting you, rejoice. Rejoice. And be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. In other words, we're not looking at our rewards down here. It's so nice for people to pat you on the back and say, hey, great job, or man, I'm watching your life and it's such an exciting thing to see you living for God. And it's wonderful, isn't it? But do you know what is even better? when they pat you on the back and say, I'm so glad for the example that you're setting, and you know it to be true, because when you go home, you know that all the things that could have destroyed your soul and the things that could have made you so religious that you saw it just in time because you measured yourself correctly and you were able to discard those things and bring in a closer relationship with God that would allow your inner person to mature, to grow before the Lord. So when I think about all these things, being blessed, the poor in spirit, persecuted, we're called the children of God, we're a part of the kingdom of God, the righteousness sake that's there, we're peacemakers, we're hungering and thirsting after righteousness sake. When we can get to the place where we can rejoice despite what others have done to us, we're growing in our faith and we're becoming more like Jesus. We're growing in our faith. Don't you want to grow? You know, I said this on Sunday. I don't want to go back to church the way we've gone, always had church. Yeah, some things will be the same. You know, we're still going to church. We're still doing song service. Some of the things will be the same. But how you feel you want to get closer to God and how you feel the church should help you to get closer to God needs to change. If that doesn't change, you will always be the weak person that you are because you're leaning on the church, the things that we do in the church house, but you're not leaning on the Christ of the church, the God of the church. You're not building your own spiritual walk with God in your own prayer closet, in your own daily walk with God. It's not the total number of hours that you pray. Why do I say prayer an hour then? It's because sometimes we don't spend enough time before God for God to speak to us, for us to learn some things before Him. That's why I always talk about Bible studies, especially. And as we do on Sundays, I try to teach and preach at the same time for those people who don't ever make it on these Bible study live streams. And even when we were in the church building, a handful of people would show up for Bible studies. Literally every single Wednesday, a handful of people. And the same amount of people who show up on a Sunday online, they don't show up even here on a Wednesday for Bible study. So I really believe that the Word of God will help to ground the way we perceive Him and the way we perceive ourselves. So we're going to measure ourselves according to the Word, and we will judge others or measure others the way the Lord wants us to, so that we don't bring a catastrophic event that will destroy your walk with God. Amen. So let's look at what follows immediately after this teaching by Jesus. Let's just take a little look at this. We often read and we talk about the Beatitudes. You know, blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who mourn and they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek. We are so versed in that. But we want to talk a little bit about the afterwards, because Jesus said something and it was quite interesting. Right after that, He begins to teach, and look at what follows. Immediately after this teaching, He begins by identifying who His followers are. If you're not sure who you are, here it is, your salt and light. That is your righteousness and godliness, your salt and light. And so we've always, you know, gone to this scripture. We talk about salt and light all the time. That salt preserves. Salt also brings flavor. So as the people of God, we preserve those things that are right and righteous before the world, so that when they see us, they're always reminded that God is watching. That's why sometimes people judge you and call you self-righteous, even though you know you're not being self-righteous. And when people say things like, do you think you're better than I am? Do you think you live better than I am? Simply because you want to live righteous before God. And the reason they're doing that is because every time they see you, they feel judged. Every time they see you, they feel condemned because they know the things that they're doing. And especially if they may not be hard sinners, but because they know they're not giving their lives to God, they know that condemns them already simply because of the life you live. We literally are the mirror for this world to see. We are godliness. We emulate godliness and righteousness before the world, and that's how God wants it to be. We are the light that shines. Even though Jesus is no longer here, we are the ones who are shining because he is in us and now he is shining through us. That's why we need to grow. That's why we need to mature so that he can shine more. Amen. And when we talk about light, we're talking about knowledge. That means you need to know the word. I was thinking about this just the other day, and we also have another Bible study on Thursdays, and I began to think about some of the things that's coming out of that Bible study as I begin to see people grow and understand the word of God. And I thought about it, and I said, you know what? We are truly the light of the world. We are emulating Christ by having knowledge to answer and to give an account of who I am. The worst thing that can ever happen is someone that tells people, I'm a Christian, I'm saved. And when that individual that they're speaking to says to them, tell me more about it and tell me what the word says, and they go mum. They can't speak because they don't know. They've never committed themselves to learning the word of God, not just reading it, but rightly dividing it, learning it. And those people that are in our Thursday Bible study, if you're on, you'll know what I'm talking about. Rightly dividing the word of truth. Because sometimes as I've been teaching Bible studies over the years, I would hear people say something concerning the word of God. And as they begin to speak it, I would look at them and let them finish. And then I would say, can I show you something else? Let me show you how you've taken that scripture out of context and show them as I rightly divided the word of God, bringing sometimes the Old Testament and the New Testament, and even sometimes using the context of that same chapter or book in the Bible to show them what was really being spoken about. So we have to know the word of God so that we can give an answer. The Apostle Paul was talking to a preacher, a young preacher by the name of Timothy, and you know, Timothy learned the word of God because the Bible says that his mother and his grandmother, they were versed in the things of God. They had knowledge and they taught Timothy. I don't know where Timothy's daddy was, but the Bible didn't mention him. It mentioned mama and grandma. And can I tell you something? Timothy knew the word, but yet still the Apostle Paul admonished him and he said, I know you know a little something, something, but you need to go deeper, Timothy. He said that God is going to call on you for more in essence, because he said to him, study to show yourself approved, a workman that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So we need to go deeper. The more you love him, the more you know who you are, the deeper you're going to want to go in the Lord. That's what salt and light means. Amen. That's what salt and light means. And we think about salt and light, and then we say to ourselves, well, I think I'm doing my best. Well, you know what? It's great when you're doing your best, but how about knowing that God has called us to a deeper walk in him, a higher walk in him, if you want to look at it that way, and that the more I know about him, which requires some work on my part. Studying requires work. Studying requires digging. Studying requires seeking. Studying the word of God gives you a power that you would not normally have. Remember, I keep saying the scripture and the Lord keeps bringing it back to my memory. I'm going to keep giving it to you. Jesus once said to his disciples that my words are spirit and they are life. So you want to grow in him? You want your life to be the best life for Christ? You get that word inside you and don't just quote it. Know what it means. Know the understanding of it so that you can get closer to him, because that's salt and light. Remember, salt and light, it brings godliness and it brings righteousness to this world. And that's important for us. We say we are Christians, but are we really Christians? Do we even know who we are? That's who we are. Salt and light. Who am I? I'm salt and light. Who am I? I'm a follower of Christ. If you're a follower of Christ, you're salt and light. If you're a follower of Christ, you know the word. If you're a follower of Christ, you're a liver and a doer of the word. Amen. And it's not easy. Wish I could sit here and tell you, oh, after 3-4 days of just seeking God, everything going to be all right. No, actually, sometimes it gets worse because the devil is going to put a beating on you and try to discredit the things that you feel in your spirit and in your heart. And he'll try to take away your deep walk with God. But the trick is to ignore him because he has no power. than what we give to him anyway, right? So if we just continue to do it, listen, I know I messed up yesterday, but I'm still going to study the word today. I know I messed up 5 hours ago, but I'm still going to pray and ask God to forgive me. I'm going to stand stronger today than I stood yesterday. And if every day you're standing strong, you're going to get stronger a little at a time. Some people, they just grow so great overnight. So it would seem. That's because they have built the outward. But how strong are they on the inside? When the trouble comes, that's when you usually find out the strong Christians. Those are the ones that can find a quiet place and never, ever, you never even know that they had a problem because they were able. I'm not saying you shouldn't talk to anybody. Please don't take me wrong or incorrect here. That's not what I'm saying. If you got to talk to somebody, talk to somebody. Amen. But I'm saying there should be a day when that thing that would always cause you to want to grab for the phone first, you should get to that point in the Lord as you grow in him. That you can go into a quiet room and just sit on a chair, cross your legs, fold your hands and just go, Lord, you know what? I'm going to just put this in your hands right now and see how you do this. And I don't care if it takes a day or a week. I'm going to wait until you bring me through this. I'm not even telling anybody, Lord. I'm going to see how you take care of me when I put my trust in you. See, you grow. And there's some things that some of us, we can do that for. Because we've grown. But then there are other things that sometimes when they come into your life, you're not ready yet. That's why we're never going to stop growing in him. Because we're going to be tested and tried often. The deeper you go in God, the more tested you are and the more tried you are. And so we can never relax our vigilance. We've got to be strong. Jesus says we're salt and light. But notice he didn't stop there because he begins to look at some other things, right? If you're salt and light, your righteousness and godliness, that means if you are who you are and you know who you are, there's some things that shouldn't be in you. He says, listen, let's talk about some things. There's some murderers out there. There are some adulterers out there. There's some who are trading evil for evil, even in the church, in the body of Christ. That's because we're not where we're supposed to be. And sometimes, to be quite honest with you, let's look at that again. Murderers, adulterers, trading evil for evil. I'm not talking about sinners out there on the streets now. I'm not talking about sinners on the streets. I'm not talking about people who've never repented of their sins, been baptized in Jesus' name, or filled with the Holy Ghost. I'm talking about Christians now, filled with the Holy Ghost, baptized in Jesus' name. They've repented of their sins. They're walking with God every single day. Yep, let me go back to that again. Murderers, adulterers, and trading evil for evil. Jesus once said to his disciples, if you hate your brother, you're a murderer. Simple as that. Yeah, the Lord says, if you look at a woman to lust, you've already committed adultery. It is so easy for us to forget that even though we may not actually do something, the very act of murder, in God's eyes, you're still a murderer if you hate your brother. So Jesus said, I don't want you to mess this up. Let's not get religious about the blessed part of it. Let's look at some things. You're salt and light. You know, your godliness and righteousness personified for the world to see. And that is better when it's coming from within, not a facade that we have built on the outside, but it's coming from within. When you're salt and light coming from inside to the outside, that's awesome. When we've built salt and light on the outside, then that facade can be destroyed easily. By one spoken word, spoken in anger, you cuss somebody out and you didn't realize that somebody that actually, you know, saw you somewhere around the church, going in and out of the church, and they just happened to see you in the supermarket. And they're like, but wait a second, I thought this person was a child of God. You know, we've got to be careful that we are not building the outward, but building on the inward, and then it will come to the outside. You can't build on the outside and goes inside. It's got to be the opposite. Put the cart behind the horse. Amen. That's what this lesson is about. Who am I? I'm a child of God. Who am I? A follower of Christ. Who am I? Salt and light. Who am I? I'm blessed. But if I'm all those things, who should I not be? You can't say, let me find out who I am. Because if you don't know who you shouldn't be, then you'll never be able to determine the right path to take. And so the Lord says, listen, there's some murderers and adulterers and those who are trading evil for evil. Even the Pharisees, they brought somebody to Jesus one day and they said, this woman was caught in the very act of adultery. Yeah, we caught her. How did they catch her again? Yeah, adultery is happening behind closed doors. How did they catch her? Yeah, well, let me tell you something. When the Lord knelt down, as they pushed her on her knees in front of the Lord for him to judge her and to tell them, go and stone her to death, because that was the law. The Lord knelt down himself. He stooped down. And, you know, I thought about that. And I said, you know, they were standing. They pushed her in front of the Lord. She was probably on her hands and her knees. And what did the Lord do? He went down to her level, but he didn't address her. He begins to write in the sand. And the Bible says that when he finished writing and he looked up, he didn't find anybody there. They left and they walked away. And he looked at the woman and he said, woman, where are your accusers? Where are the ones that caught you in the very act of adultery? And yeah, they wanted you stoned to death. But what happened? Where are they? She says, Lord, I don't know. I was too busy waiting for you to tell them to stone me. I don't know what he wrote. We have so many people that can try to figure it out. But it could have been that he wrote their own sins. It could have been that one of them was actually the one that committed adultery with her. But because somehow she didn't do something for them, they decided they were going to get her stoned. And so when Jesus wrote, they left. And this is what the Lord said to her. Since they're not here and they can't condemn you, he says, neither do I condemn you. Go, but don't do that thing anymore. You see, that's how we know when we are doing the right thing, is that when we catch ourselves doing some things we're not supposed to be doing, we ought to say, no, 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 no. Yeah, put a little music and a little beat behind that. That's right. No, 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 no. Don't do it again. Hold ourselves accountable and say, I cannot do this thing because the Lord is seeing me. He says, listen, they are murderers and adulterers, trading evil for evil. I don't want you to be that way. And you know how I know that? Because Jesus then brings us back to what's important. He says, yes, you're blessed. There's murderers and adulterers and people who are trading evil amongst the brethren. But then he says this, I also want you to remember one thing that is very important for you to do. Love your enemies. Love your enemies. Amen. When I thought about that, I thought about the fruit of the Spirit. Galatians chapter 5 and verse 22 through 23 says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. Herein, amen, are the qualities of a person who is truly spiritual. Herein are we're talking about the evidence that shines forth. You know, some of us, we want to be so busy doing spiritual things in the open so others can see us, and we are not busy enough doing these things in secret where nobody sees us. This is where the work should be put in. You know, I often thought about how we want to do church. Well, one of the things that the Lord impressed on me is that we need to teach this over and over again, that we have to get in a place where we're working on ourselves long before you get to the church house. Because if we are not right at the church house, no, nothing that we do will prosper. God can't operate in the church when things are not right and when things are not righteous and when we have drawn lines of demarcation and you're over there with your team and that person is over there with theirs and there's another group over here. No, 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 no. That's not church. That's not church. I don't know what you call that, but that's not church. But church is where people begin to put their own personal issues to the side and say once and for all, no matter what's going on, you know, I'm not going to let anything bother me. So what if they don't talk to you in the church building? So what if you go up to them and say hi to them? I mean, I'm the pastor, but I've walked up to people and I say hello and they don't even respond back to me. They look me straight in the face and don't say a word. You think I'm going to go and lose sleep over that? No, I'm going to even pray for that person and say, God, I don't know what their issue is, but whatever it is, help them. And that happened recently, so I know what I'm talking about. You got to say to yourself, if you walk around with that stuff in your spirit and in your heart, you're destroying your own walk with God. Now, hold on a second. Can you imagine now if everybody begins to get that revelation? It starts with one person. But if everybody begins to get that revelation, then it becomes such a wonderful situation where now when the presence of God begins to move, where people are not walking in there with all these things that Jesus said shouldn't be in our hearts anyway. Can you imagine the power of God, the healing that can take place? Some of us want the church to fix you, but the church can't fix you. Some of you want the pastor to fix you, but can I tell you, the pastor can't fix you. You have got to get your walk right with God. That's what I'm teaching you. This is how we do in church from now on, man. This is how we do in church. If you can't do it, I'm going to keep teaching it till you hear it, till there's a conviction on you that you know you've got to get this right at the crib, in your own house, in your own prayer room. If you don't have a prayer room when nobody's awake, you find a time to pray and you go before the Lord and write down some of those things that you know that's not right in your life. Write down some of those things that you're trying to get right, but there's so many obstacles that's getting in your way from you to getting right with God. And pray over those things and say, God, help me, and I'm going to be as white as snow, Lord. Right now, God, I'm a mess, but I'm going to be right with you. God, right now I'm harboring some things in my heart, but God, I know you're going to help me. God, I know I'm not where I'm supposed to be, but I'm not letting that stop me. I'm going to keep bringing myself before you. You see, if you create that altar in your house, you see, if you create that altar in your car, you see, if you create that altar when you're on the bus and on the train, you see, if you create that altar on your lunch and break time on the job, and you begin to work on you, you'll really know who you are. And then when you walk into the house of God, miracles will begin to happen because the church is in unity. It is unified. Everybody say unified. Yeah, I heard three people. That's good. Let's say it again. Everybody say unified. Oop, four people. Well, you're catching on. You're catching on. The fruit of the Spirit. We need to develop this in our lives and let the evidence of these things that we work on through prayer begin to grow in us. You know, there are some challenges, right? Yep. There are some challenges. The teachings of the Word of God emphasizes the reformation of the inside of a person first, trusting that the outside will naturally follow. That's the Word of God. How we read the Word, it's always exemplifying these things. That what we do, it has to begin from the inside, and it works its way when it's developed to the outside. Amen. And so when I thought about this, I started to think of two words here. Number one, it is confirmation or conforming. Sometimes we conform to things, you know, because people say, hey, listen, I'm a Christian, and so I've got to portray what a Christian really looks like. And so we don't work on the transforming part as we work on the conforming part of it. You see, when you conform to something, you become like it. Yeah, when you work on the conforming part, you work on something that looks like it. Yeah, you conform. And so the Bible says, don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So that transformation part is the right thing. But let's take that out of context just a little bit. I know many of us don't want to conform to the world, but sometimes we conform to the religious world, the things that are religious. We conform to some things and we begin to try to make ourselves look and act like so that people will think that we are like. But that's not helping you. It's not going to help any of us because that's not what it's about. But when we begin to build from the inside, then it becomes transforming. Transforming takes more time than simply conforming. When you transform something, it takes work and effort because now you know, well, you know what? If I make it look like a car, but there's no engine in it, and it's not really a car, is it? Even if I put an engine in there and I say it's a Mercedes-Benz top of the line, but if there's no power windows and you don't have power seats and, you know, you might put some other things in there that's low budget, but if you don't put all the stuff that a Mercedes-Benz would have in there, it look like a Mercedes-Benz on the outside. And when you go on the inside, some things might even begin to look like it. The steering wheel looks like it. But if you start touching stuff inside, quickly you'll realize that something is really wrong here. You either got the low, 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 really low budget Mercedes-Benz, or somebody's trying to pull the wool over your eyes. But when you begin to transform something, it begins on the inside. The Bible says, be transformed by the renewing of your minds. And so as we're being renewed on the inside and we begin to do what Jesus said, we're blessed people, blessed. And there's so much about that that you can look at again in Matthew chapter 5 and beginning at verse 3 when he begins to speak about those that are blessed and how we're blessed. But then he begins to say, listen, even though you're blessed, people are going to come against you. They're going to accuse you. They're going to say false things against you for his name's sake. There are people that will persecute you. But he said the prophets were persecuted as well. And he said, if you're all these things are happening for my sake, because you're living for me, you love me, he said, don't worry about it. You're going to be all right. But then he said, there are some things that shouldn't be among us. We need to work on those things. If we are really who we say we're supposed to be, we've got to work on not being a murderer. Stop hitting your brother and your sister. We've got to work on not being an adulterer. You know, sometimes it's not even about that physical adultery or looking at another woman, sir, or another man, ma'am. It could also be spiritual adultery because we are looking at other things and replacing God with those things, replacing church with those things. That's spiritual adultery. And God looks at that very seriously. And one of the reasons why adultery is one of the things that so many times churches preach against, because the Bible says it's wrong, is because God looks at the relationship with the church like he looks at a marriage between a man and a woman. He says you ought to be committed to one another and never let anything come between you. And he says, so as you are, I am with my church. Lord, he takes his relationship with the church and he says, it resembles your marriage, sir, with your wife, your marriage, ma'am, with your husband. God takes that very seriously. And when we begin to replace God with other things, and we may not bring Baal or some other idols in, but we'll replace it with other things. Yeah. And I've preached and taught about that often enough to say that sometimes some of the very religious things that we bring in, that's a spiritual adultery, because some of those things are not even in the word, not even in the word. And when you build that outward facade of Christianity and there's nothing on the inside, that is spiritual idolatry, because you're replacing a true walk with God with something else. That's spiritual idolatry or spiritual adultery. So that's very important. So think about it. That work in transformation is not easy, because transforming is working on oneself every day to become a true follower of Christ. Amen. So easy to put on a front, to pretend to be something that we are not. But the Lord sees us as we really are. Never forget that. So the question is, who am I? A follower of Christ and a doer of his word. Who am I really? A follower of Christ and a doer of his word. And that's very important. Amen. Two things I want to leave with you. Be careful how you measure others. Be careful how you measure others. And make sure that you are truthfully measuring yourself. You're truthfully measuring yourself. Because if we are who we're supposed to be and we know who we are, we won't judge someone else because they're failing. We won't measure them incorrectly. We won't say, oh, you're just, look at you. You know how many times, I know some of y'all have done it so many times, probably even done it today, fighting with somebody and look them in the face and go, and you call yourself a Christian. Well, first of all, that is just something, isn't it? That the one with the mote in their eye calling out someone with a beam in their eye, rather calling someone else with a small mote in their eye. You know what? When we do that, that means we don't understand ourselves, because if you understood yourself, you would never look at somebody and say, you call yourself a Christian. We all fail. But the trick is to forgive one another and to bring ourselves under subjection to the Spirit of God so that God can help us. And even if it comes out of your mouth, don't beat yourself up about it. Go to the person and say, I'm sorry that I said that to you. What's wrong with that? Some of y'all don't even love to, you hate the act of actually going to somebody and saying to them, I'm sorry. You hate that. Well, that means because you have not grown within and you have a lot of growth. If you can't ask somebody to forgive you, eat crow. And even if you know they're not going to forgive you, they probably curse you out. Go and say, look, I'm sorry. When they start cursing you out, just leave. But at least you said you're sorry and you know it came from your heart. Because now you're going to grow, and then you're going to be able to show them through the growth in you that you're not being impacted by what they're doing. You never know. It just might help them to grow themselves in the Lord. So those two things, keep them in mind. Be careful how you measure others and be truthful in how you are measuring yourselves. Who am I? Who am I today? That's a question we ought to ask ourselves as we go before the Lord in prayer. Who am I? Hallelujah. The songwriter says, who am I that a king should bleed and die for? Who am I that I should pray, not my will, but thine for? The answer, I may never know why he ever loved me so, that to an old rugged cross he would go. For who am I? Lord, we come to you right now. We thank you. Thank you for your mercy and your grace. We thank you for this Bible study tonight. We ask you, God, that you'll anoint our hearts and our minds and help us to, Lord God, truly begin to measure ourselves so that we can become truly who we're supposed to be in the kingdom of God. I pray for us tonight, God, as we look at our world in the condition that it is in and all that's happening, to never forget that work that we're supposed to be putting in transforming ourselves. Some of the transformation happens through the Holy Ghost, but some of it is definitely us bending our will to yours, Lord God, and saying, God, you have your way. And in this house, Lord, in this physical and spiritual house of us, Lord God, have your way today. And Lord, we will give you the praise and the glory and the honor. And would someone say, in Jesus' name, amen. I thank you tonight for being here with us for this Bible study. And I hope that it helped somebody, that it touched your heart as much as it touched mine and began to make some transformation in myself. I pray that it will begin to make some transformation in you as well. Thanks again for joining. And for those again who are joining from overseas, thank you always for just being here. There's several of you, and we're just appreciative of you taking your time to be with us. May God bless you. May God bless your family. Stay strong in Jesus. Until next time, in Jesus' name,